Good afternoon. Thank you again to Professor Boyd for inviting me to talk. I should state that, as he said, I was a former fiscal, although I have a continuing interest in medical law as such. So to that extent, everything I say is completely independent of the Procurator Fiscal Service. The Procurator Fiscal, and I deliberately called it the role in sudden death, and I want to go back because I didn't know the level of knowledge in the room of actually what the Procurator Fiscal does. So here goes. At 19 years old, Beryl Ewing's daughter, Suzanne, had everything to look forward to. Then suddenly she was gone. 19, full of life and fun, with a smile as bright as her future. One day, Suzanne was getting ready for an overtime shift. She came to me and said, "Mum, I'm going to faint." And then she died right in front of me. I phoned the ambulance and they told me to do CPR, but that was it. There was no warning, no signs she hadn't been unwell. It's Monday morning, as the Procurator Fiscal deputy in the death unit. What I've just read is not an unfamiliar death notification that I would have received. The action that I'm about to instruct was relatively routine within my years in the death unit in Glasgow. I'm going to instruct a post-mortem report. It's a Procurator Fiscal post-mortem, and I'll come back to that. Though I will not seek consent to that post-mortem, I would take the family's views, religious or cultural beliefs, into account in determining whether to instruct a post-mortem and in the arrangements made for the post-mortem examination to be carried out. Advising the family of the action that I was taking would be a prerequisite, though crucially, and I'd ask you to bear that in mind, it would not probably be me personally. But let's step back. In my talk today, I'm going to look at the Procurator Fiscal, the role in sudden death. Largely, that role does not vary from sudden death to sudden death, hence no reference specifically to cardiac death. To many previously uninvolved with the Procurator Fiscal Service, families are confused, seemingly, by the role of the Scottish Criminal Prosecutor in what is an immensely distressing and emotional time for families. I want to look at the background to instructing that post-mortem, the PF procedures following the notification of the death, and to conclude briefly with a brief look at some of the problems, though unfortunately not the answers, to the issues faced by those involved in such tragic deaths. The background. Death is certain. That comes from a rap artist. But investigating the cause of death is of immediate interest to all of us, especially when we are next of kin. The public interest in death, though, is much wider. Criminal and civil justice requires certification of the cause of death, be it the case of criminal law, to permit murders to be detected, or in civil law, to allow the administration of the deceased estate. All legal systems make investigations into sudden, suspicious, accidental, unexpected, and unexplained deaths, as well as any death that's reported to them. Across Scotland, there are approximately 13,500 sudden, unexpected, unexplained deaths reported annually to the Procurator Fiscal. In the majority of these cases, inquiries will establish that the death is due to natural causes. Historically, the PF's role comes about because of the primary function to investigate and prosecute in the public interest and include criminality and death. It is not a statutory function, and I ask you to remember that when you consider the responsibilities in due course. The role is to investigate in the public interest impartially, and that's on behalf of no party, and to arrive at the truth. However, as the investigation ensues, and in that I include the post-mortem examination, so does the public interest, potentially, in learning the truth of that death. Why else would the Procurator Fiscal represent the public interest and be responsible in leading discretionary fatal accident inquiries. Now, I don't have time here to go into them because it's a short talk, but I can obviously talk later. In certain cardiac deaths, there are circumstances where I could imagine such deaths could give rise to a fatal accident inquiry being instructed by the Lord Advocate. Think of a death at a school. Would life-saving equipment or the speed of the medical response, i.e. doctors inside, perhaps the cardiologist, on the touch, at the lines, be someone that might have saved this child's life? You can see the emotive issues arising. The general duty to report a death lies with the person who has knowledge of the death and its circumstances. The death will be reported to the procurator fiscal, in which there is the closest connection, or sometimes we call it nexus. If the death is reportable, the report will include details of the death, the circumstances, and a brief medical history to allow the procurator fiscal to assess the situation. And that largely is what I read you out at the outset, which is taken from a death that was reported in the internet. Secondly, I now want to talk about the procedures following death notification. The procurator fiscal does not need to instruct postmortems in every case, and it may be worth briefly indicating how a sudden cardiac death will not usually fit into these other procedures. The issue of a death certificate without postmortem can be authorised. A six-year-old man, interestingly, it's over the 40 years that we've been talking about, with a previous history of heart attacks and a medication for angina, is found dead in his house. The GP has not seen him for several weeks. The death is reportable, it's sudden. Unless there are any concerns from the relatives, the procurator fiscal will normally accept that certification from the doctor without further inquiry. Death has been sudden, unexpected, no more investigation is required. A second situation is where the doctor themselves cannot or doesn't feel able to grant a death certificate. After a brief history is obtained, the pathologist may be invited to view and grant a death certificate. Based on the medical history, perhaps of a chronic alcoholic who has succumbed to disease with no suspicious circumstances, the pathologist is satisfied and will issue a death certificate for cirrhosis of the liver. Again, a sudden death, no further inquiry is required. Finally, however, as in the cases that you're outlining here of cardiac death, a postmortem will be instructed. There's no medical history or circumstances to allow a doctor to certify. Cause of death unknown. Once the postmortem is carried out, the death will frequently, and to that I will defer to Robert, will be certified for the time being as unascertained, pending further investigation. There the role of the PS immediate interest concludes, as that body can then be released for funeral. At least I understand in some areas of Scotland that doesn't happen, but certainly in Glasgow it did. That will only take a matter of a few days, and the family are then free to progress to the funeral. Any criminality is, of course, excluded by that examination by the pathologist. And now, lastly, I want to talk about the problems that we encounter, the ones that you're discussing today. And there's perhaps several to highlight. The first is the potential delay in the funeral arrangements. If a final cause of death, and by that I mean the sorts of things that were being talked about, is required, then delay will be inevitable as further clinical or examinations are required, because that requires time. That can take some weeks, depending how busy the pathologist may be. Many families do not want that delay, so this recognised process of ascertained allows the funeral to proceed. Delaying all funeral arrangements pending final death certification may well cause administrative and practical problems in most big cities. Should there be one approach to such practices across Scotland? From the PS perspective, the question of criminality has been excluded. A final diagnosis as to the cause of death is, of course, required. But in due course, the pathologist will give us that, and then Obviously, the family would be told, and the final cause of death can then be registered with the Register of Births, Deaths and Marriage as required. So that's the first problem I see. The second is in relation to investigations. That, as you've heard already, is not the end of the matter in sudden cardiac deaths. The FAM statement indicates that those under 40 dying unexpectedly have tissue taken for DNA extraction and storage. That assists, as we've heard, in finalising the cause of death, as well as looking at the future health of the family and the first degree relatives to which we've had the graphic demonstration. However, from my perspective, the role of the Procurator Fiscal is completed. The funeral has proceeded, but it was the Procurator Fiscal that instructed the post-mortem. The pathologist has no relationship with the deceased relatives. The final cause of death will be communicated by the Fiscal to the relatives in due course, once the pathologist tells us. But bear in mind, there is no lawyer-client relationship between the Procurator Fiscal and the deceased, but there does exist a means of communication. Turning back to Beryl Ewing, the case I outlined at the beginning, the post-mortem concluded that Suzanne had died of natural causes. A second post-mortem revealed a heart condition, arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy, and I'm only glad I managed to pronounce it, I think, correctly. Significantly, her mother now indicates that we now know that Suzanne's condition was hereditary, so the family goes to London regularly to be tested. The PF is well placed to issue a letter to the family recommending screening to relevant relatives. Such a letter is bound to be distressing. Practices would need to be standardised to ensure that in all relevant desks that such a letter was sent. Key to such letter is the provision both of the final cause of death, but information to support the family at this time to be able to access information about the need, purposes and background to scanning. The recent events involving a well-known footballer, I suspect, may have done more for publicity in this area of medicine than any other. And to that extent, come back to the Fatal Accident Inquiry. One of the purposes of them, when they're discretionary, is for a sheriff to make determination. These inquiries receive much publicity, as those of you who may recently have seen the results of a mineshaft, the lawyer who died in the mineshaft. These are looked at with great scrutiny, so it is a place for publicity. The PF role, however, I would indicate, was restricted to one of communication. No more, no less. They are not the experts. Referral needs to be made to those that can inform the families properly, and that's the medical profession. Finally, I want to conclude with a few words about the emotive issues and interests of a lawyer. We do not have the absolute right, ethically or legally, to do what we want with our body. The background to these concerns originates clearly, as far as I'm concerned, in the government inquiries following the organ retention scandals at Alderhay and Bristol. These inquiries do play a part, but as ever with law and medicine, shifting times play a role as well. There's a much greater interest in the public in medical practices, accountability, respect for the individual, less deferential attitudes towards the medical profession of the doctor is always right, and perhaps, unfortunately or fortunately, interest in body parts from both an ethical and commercial perspective. There is a balance to be struck between the family's right to dignity and the public interest in death, which is much wider than the simple death certification which I've perhaps outlined to you. The public interest could be said to span medical research, education, training and public health. In an example I borrow from Professor Bobby and Kenny Mason's article in Modern Law Review, we can perhaps reflect that dilemma. A post-mortem indicates death as coronary insufficiency. Another post-mortem certifies death as due to myocardial infarction due to coronary insufficiency. That follows an examination of retained tissue. Whose post-mortem is best? Looking at our interest today, the second post-mortem has given us results that are best. It allows the use of advancing medical practices to identify with more clear focus the cause of death. But I now turn back to the role of the Procurator Fiscal in death, and that is of the public interest. Seeking to justify these actions of retaining tissue as being the public interest will face understandable suspicion that the state might actually be working in its own interest. Using the public interest may be seen as a smokescreen for external justification of such actions. We've already heard reference to Section 38 and 9 of the Human Tissue Scotland Act under Section 40. These deal specifically with the use of tissue samples and organs once the Procurator Fiscal's interest is concluded and the requirements of notice satisfied. That leaves these issues rightly in the domain of the pathologist who is the expert and that of the medical profession. The PF interest, I would be the first to support the retention of these items where there's any question of criminality, because in court I'm going to require to refer to them and have the necessary links. However, when my interest is concluded, because it is not a criminal death and it is a matter perhaps in the civil area, it should go back to the medical profession. They are the experts, not me. I'd be concerned about the extension of the Procurator Fiscal role in medical areas. Finally, a duty of care is a term that may well be bandied about. Duty of care derives from the common law. When does it arise? The duty of the Procurator Fiscal to the public is to the public, not to the family. There is no client relationship. Is there an expectation of a duty of care or an assumption of responsibility? I do not think so, because to do so would be to hijack the role of the Procurator Fiscal. However, in the public interest, I leave you with one thought. I am satisfied that the right to provide information to relatives must be seen as mandatory. Thank you.
I think in the interest of time, because I've